la quinta serie de conferencias Lectures. Muchas gracias a los sobrevivientes hasta el final de que han logrado pasar todas las conferencias Lectures. Siempre es siempre es muy importante para nosotros esta actividad aquí con alguien y agradecemos su asistencia. Y es un honor para nosotros presentar al profesor Edward Whitten del Instituto de Estudios Avanzados, hablando de Quantum Gravity. Profesor Whitten.
Thanks so much for the kind introduction, and thanks again to Sindhastar for the invitation to give these lectures, and congratulations to Sindhastar and IPM on the anniversaries we're celebrating. So I'm going to be talking about quantum gravity, which is supposed to be a theory, a quantum theory of course, in which the geometry of space-time can fluctuate. So according to Einstein, gravity is a theory in which space-time is not a predetermined arena in which physics happens, but rather the whole idea of Einstein's theory of gravity is that it describes the dynamics of space-time. So quantum gravity would have to describe the quantum dynamics of space-time in some sense. So naively speaking, what quantum gravity means is that we start with classical gravity described by the Einstein Hilbert theory, and then we quantize it. Now, formally, there's no problem in doing this. You can write down formal perturbative rules for quantization. And how to do this has been known essentially since the 60s with the work of pioneers such as Bryce DeWitt. But it doesn't work well in practice. The theory is unnormalizable. And it also appears to suffer from conceptual problems where general relativity reaches its limits in black holes and the Big Bang. Now, although naively speaking we want to quantize the Einstein-Hilbert theory, that is most probably too narrow a way to look at the problem. A better statement of the problem is that we want to find a better theory that looks like general relativity at long distances, but can be quantized. Just to give a historical analogy, once upon a time there was the Fermi theory of weak interactions. And it could, although it made sense in perturbation theory, it was unnormalizable. It couldn't really be quantized seriously. And the solution wasn't to find a way to quantize the Fermi theory. Rather, the Lashall-Weinberg-Sorn model was a better model that could be quantized. So here, one should expect, we've only tested general relativity at long distances. The idea is not naively to quantize general relativity, but to find a theory that agrees with what we know of general relativity and can be quantized. We shouldn't assume that the better theory we're looking for is a theory of metrics and space-time geometries. Since there are many examples in physics where a more microscopic description involves completely different ingredients from what one sees macroscopically. For example, superconductors emerge from the Schrödinger equation of electrons and nuclei. You don't describe a superconductor by quantizing superconductivity, whatever that would mean, but rather by learning how it's built out of electrons and nuclei. Protons and neutrons emerge from the quantum theory of quarks and gluons. You don't understand nuclear physics by quantizing protons and neutrons, but by finding the better theory that can be more successfully quantized. Now, why would we care about quantum gravity, given that the energy scale of quantum gravity is so high that at best, experimental clues are going to be extremely limited? Well, conceptually, there must be some limit to how well we can understand nature without making quantum mechanics and gravity work together. And because quantum mechanics and gravity are such successful theories, it's more or less inevitable to be curious about how they can work together. There's also at least one quantum gravity effect. This is what I'm about to tell you is quite surprising. It's kind of a gift from nature. But there is actually one quantum gravity effect that might actually be observable experimentally. That has to do with the polarization of the cosmic microwave radiation produced in the Big Bang. It's observed to be slightly polarized. So the radiation you see, if you put a telescope looking at the sky, basically, at microwave frequencies, is observed to be just slightly polarized. And there's an effect of the twisting of this polarization
generated by quantum gravity that may actually be observable in the next few years or in the next decade. So there's at least one case where we might actually test quantum gravity, but more generally, with our present understanding of the Big Bang, the best theory that we have is certainly the inflationary universe, but any serious thinking about cosmic inflation tends to lead to questions about quantum mechanics and gravity. Of course, I don't know, but they might be questions we won't be able to answer. Or we might come up with theoretical answers that won't tell us much about the real world. That's always part of the risk in theoretical science. And there are a few other things that we've observed, such as the apparent indication of gauge couplings of weak interaction of particle physics, and also the neutrino masses, that possibly originate at an energy scale close to that of quantum gravity. And in the future, there might be a few more observed phenomena of such kinds. So, although the energy scale is so vast, there are at least some possibilities of some experimental things, but admittedly probably bigger ones. But beyond that, quantum gravity is something we're bound to be curious about, given how successful gravity and general relativity are separately. Given how successful quantum mechanics and general relativity are separately, we're bound to be curious about how they can work together. Yet, I have to say personally that because the energy scale is so remote and the clue is so meager, I personally wouldn't have tried to work on quantum gravity, except that unexpectedly, it turned out that it was possible to do interesting things with it. And my goal today is to tell you a little bit about a few of those interesting things, in a way that's aimed to not require too much previous experience. Of course, I've made a highly idiosyncratic selection with the aim of A, fitting the talk into 1 hour, and B, trying to be relatively widely understandable. So, what is known about quantum gravity is an odd mix of things. I wasn't sure what to explain today, but I put together an odd mix based on the idea of emphasizing the relations between quantum gravity and ordinary theories without gravity. So, by an ordinary theory without gravity, I mean a quantum theory of the kind we study in the lab, or that describes most of physics. So, an ordinary theory without gravity here means a quantum theory, usually a quantum field theory if one goes into depth. So, the ordinary theories are the quantum theories that we use to study electrons, quarks, and nuclei, and so on. And what I'll be emphasizing today are relations between quantum theories that do describe gravity and ordinary theories, meaning quantum theories that don't describe gravity. So, to say it again, I'll be stressing what we know about relations between the familiar quantum theories without gravity and the mysterious quantum theory that does describe gravity. And we're going to start in one dimension, but we will count our dimensions relativistically, so one dimension means one space-time dimension, a very meager dimension for quantum gravity. See, so if we ask for our one-dimensional space-time to be a manifold, it would be too simple. We would just have a line or a circle. We wouldn't have sufficient complexities to get into the kind of model I'm going to talk about. So we're instead going to allow a one-dimensional manifold to have some singularities. That is, we'll allow a graph. So this is a model of our one-dimensional space-time. Don't worry about how it's embedded in two or three dimensions to draw it. Intrinsically, we've got one-dimensional curves, but they're joined together at vertices, making a graph. So I've drawn a graph with 9 edges, glued together at 4 vertices, but we'll allow a wide variety of graphs with different numbers of vertices and edges. And we want to do Riemannian geometry on a graph. After all, we're trying to do gravity. Gravity means Riemannian geometry, according to Einstein. But we're going to do our Riemannian geometry quantum mechanically. So we're going to be doing quantum Riemannian geometry in one dimension. And you see, it would have been too simple without the graph, because there aren't enough Riemannian manifolds in one dimension. But allowing graphs gives us a lot of one-dimensional Riemannian spaces. We shouldn't call them Riemannian manifolds, but they're Riemannian. Now, up to reparameterizations, the only invariants of the metric on a graph are the lengths of the segments. So here, I've imagined that on this singular one-dimensional space, we've placed a Riemannian metric, but up to diffeomorphisms or reparametrizations, all we care about are the lengths of the segments. So I didn't label all nine segments, but this one has length t1, this one has length t2, and this one has length t3. And doing quantum gravity means we're going to allow different possible graphs, and we're also going to say something about the Riemannian metrics of the graphs. And in discussing the Riemannian metrics of the graphs, we're going to consider two extreme models. In one model, we will set all the t's to 1. In the other model, we will allow all possible t's, and we will integrate them with the values of t. You can make combinations of these two models, but these are the extreme cases. Completely specifying the t's or allowing all possible t's. So for illustrative purposes, well, what I know, for what I know, these two illustrative cases are the basic ones. So if you set all the t's to 1, you're really just counting graphs. What have we got? Well, if all the t's are 1, they don't carry information, so all we have is the graph itself. But there are many different graphs. And what can the Feynman path integral of our one-dimensional quantum gravity theory mean? All it can really mean is to count graphs, to sum over graphs. Feynman says sum over paths, or histories, but in our one-dimensional model of quantum gravity, the history is the graph. And if the lengths are all 1, all we're doing is counting graphs. But when we count, we can include coupling constants that keep track of the number of vertices. So for example, in our sum over histories, this happens to be a 4-valent graph, 4-valent vertex, 4 lines meet here, but only 3 lines meet here. And over here, it looks like 6 lines are meeting. This is 5. So I've allowed different types of valency, but the valency of the vertices is an invariant of the geometry. So in doing our Feynman integral, we'll permit ourselves, when we count graphs, to weight each graph by factors that depend upon the valency of the vertices. So we'll include a factor lambda 3 for every 3 valent vertex, a factor lambda 4 for every 4 valent vertex, and so on. So in this model of quantum gravity, we sum over graphs, weighting each graph by factor for each vertex. There's actually a very good way to count graphs. Well, where did Feynman get Feynman graphs from? He got Feynman graphs from Feynman integrals. But here, our Feynman integral will be zero-dimensional, so it won't really be a Feynman integral. It will just be a Newton integral, or a Leibniz integral. Our Feynman integral here will just be the ordinary integral over the real line, over a scalar field, except it's just a real number. But the function that we'll integrate will be the exponential of minus Gaussian, minus the nth positive, but then the fractions involving phi cubed, phi fourth, and so on, with arbitrary parameters, lambda 3, lambda 4, and so on. And then this integral is a function of lambda, so I've called it z of lambda 3, lambda 4, and so on, where z is a common name for the partition function of a physical system. For this system, a partition function is just the integral. Now, there's something you should know here, which I don't, to fully understand today's lecture, there's something you should know, which I'm not going to explain. It helps to know that Feynman, that integrals, such as this one, can be expanded in graphs. You see, if lambda 3 and lambda 4 and so on were 0, we'd have a Gaussian integral, which we'd evaluate according to Gaussian, the integral of the square root of pi or something. When we turn on lambda 3 and lambda 4, a series, an asymptotic expansion in powers of lambda, is generated by graphs, which would be the Feynman arguments. So Feynman's recipe, and I apologize to those of you who haven't studied at all Feynman integrals and Feynman diagrams, but Feynman's recipe for calculating such a graph shows that this integral can be evaluated by precisely summing over all possible graphs with each graph weighted by a factor in each vertex, according to its valency. So this graph would be weighted by lambda 3 times lambda 4 times lambda 5 times lambda 6. Anyway, Feynman would tell us that this integral can be evaluated by counting graphs that are suitably weighted. Now, what do we get when we count graphs? Well, we get a pretty strange discrete sum that doesn't look like much of a space-time. And remember, we started 10 minutes ago by saying we wanted to do quantum space-time. So, a graph, if we really care about the details of this particular graph with 9 edges and so on, is terribly discrete. We want to build up something with a space-time determination. And an idea now is to adjust the parameters so that a typical graph has many vertices and somehow builds a macroscopic one-dimensional geometry. Only the trouble is that we don't have any experience about what a macroscopic one-dimensional quantum geometry is supposed to be. So we don't know quite what we're trying to get. But we'll prove, therefore, we'll prove this idea in a second. But a naive version of the idea would be to adjust the parameters to some critical values where you somehow will get a model of quantum gravity in one dimension. So, it's actually better. The trouble here is that it's hard to get any insight about the meaning of a dense random graph. So, if lambda 3 and lambda 4 are properly adjusted, our random graph generically will be very dense. But we don't have any insight about what it means. So, I want to improve the model in a way that was done in the 1980s by Sasha Bingle and others. I won't try to give old references. Where we will, out of a very similar model, be able to get a semi-classical picture. Here, instead of abstract graphs, we'll consider graphs drawn on two-dimensional surfaces. So, here I've taken the two-dimensional surface to be the screen on which the picture is projected. So, see, before when we had a graph, lines were crossing. So this graph, although actually this one could have been drawn on the plane by bending this line around here. I didn't really draw the whole thing. But here, we're now going to imagine we restrict the picture slightly and we force our graphs to be drawn on a two-dimensional surface. So an abstract graph wouldn't tell us what the two-dimensional surface is. To get around that, I've drawn what mathematicians call fat graphs. Instead of an abstract line here, I've drawn a little thin ribbon. And I've joined the ribbons. So this four-valent graph, four-valent vertex, is now a junction of four little ribbons. So if you ignore the thickness of the ribbons, what you see is a graph. But the ribbons tell you something, because the edges of the ribbons form loops. And each loop you think of as the boundary of the disk, which in this case is just the disk which is on the screen. So with the information you get from the ribbons, you can build up a two-dimensional surface on which the graph can be drawn. So for the moment, the double lines of ribbons are just meant to guide the eye in constructing a two-dimensional surface from the graph. The abstract graph doesn't let us know what the two-dimensional surface is. But when we draw ribbons instead of lines, the information about the two-dimensional surface is there. Now, remember, there are going to be two approaches, which is that either we fix the lengths of the edges, or else we integrate over the lines. But for the moment, we're still fixing the lengths. So we're going to imagine that, therefore, that all edges have the same length. And therefore, we can think of the polygons here as being equilateral. Since it's a random graph, it's hard to draw it on the slide in a way that makes all the things equilateral. But imagine in your mind's eye that the lengths are the same and the triangles are all equilateral. And in this example, they're all triangles, but have they been quadrilaterals, pentagons, and so on, let them all be regular. And then we have a two-dimensional geometry. Because, you see, if these were all equilateral triangles glued together on their edges, what we've built up is a two-dimensional geometry, which admittedly is a little bit bumpy. It's a little bumpy at the vertices. It's not really bumpy at the edges, because, see, I can fold a sheet of paper, but the intrinsic Riemannian geometry doesn't have a singularity. So the intrinsic geometry, when I glue together the triangles at the edges, is nice. But at this corner, I've glued together five polygons whose angles don't add up to 2 pi. So there's a conical singularity here. So although we build up a two-dimensional geometry, it has a lot of conical singularities. Again, we're going to allow all possible two-dimensional geometries of this kind, built by gluing together regular polygons. And we're going to count them the same way we did for the abstract rings, weighting three-valent, four-valent vertices and so on, by coupling parameters of N3 and N4. It was explained in the 70s by Hooft, who later won the Nobel Prize for his work on the weak inversions, how to write a path integral that does the counting for us. Only this path integral maybe should be, again, more called a Newton Leibniz integral than a Feynman integral, because it's infinitely many dimensions. Instead of a single scalar field phi, we take a matrix valued field phi ij, where I and j run from 1 to n. Then the double line keeps track of the flow of the two types of indices, I and j. When I draw not an abstract line, but a double one, think of the two edges as corresponding to the two indices, or the two the initial and final matrix elements of the matrix. And then in a general graph, if phi is an n by n matrix, when you draw the picture, you think of each edge of the ribbon as keeping track of one index I or j. And since I or j have n possible values, each little loop gives you a factor of n. So if n is large, so now when we do the sum over graphs, we're going to weight each graph by a coupling parameter at each vertex, but also by a factor of n for each little polygon. So if n is large, the dominant graphs are those with the closed index loops. And if you use the Gauss-Bonnet theorem or the Euler guidance or something, you learn after a while that these are they keep and fix the types of the vertices. The graphs with the most loops are the ones that can be drawn on the surface of a two-scale. So now we're getting close to some kind of geometry. The metric is a little bit singular in its conical singularities, but we're still building up predominantly a two-dimensional sphere with some kind of metric that's allowed to cover it. So we can think of what we're doing as a model of some kind of two-dimensional quantum gravity. But how are we supposed to do the sum of the random graphs weighted by these factors of n for loops and lambda-3, lambda-4, and so on for vertices? There's an analog of what I told you before, which is that, and this is a really Hooft's insight from the 70s, that there's a matrix integral that does the job for you. The sum of your discrete two-dimensional geometries that you want can be calculated by integrating over all matrix elements of an n by n matrix. The integral of the matrix is just an ordinary Riemannian integral over each of the n squared matrix elements of an n by n matrix. And what we integrate is the exponential of the same thing we had before, except because it's all matrix value, we take a trace, and then we multiply by n in the exponent. Then it turns out, that this I'm now describing something that was done very successfully in the 80s. If you take n to infinity while suitably adjusting the parameters so that the complexity of a typical graph diverges, you actually can get a continuum model of two-dimensional gravity. So this is an improvement on the naive model with a single phi rather than an n by n matrix. Because in the other case, we got a dense graph, but we didn't have any semi-classical, any insight about what a dense graph meant. Here, the dense graph is constructing a two-dimensional geometry. So this, a kind of this simple integral is actually a model of quantum gravity in the two-dimensional spacetime. Now, how's it related to the naive model we started with at the beginning? The naive model is just the special case where n is 1. Then the n by n matrix becomes a 1 by 1 matrix, in other words, a single real variable. You drop the n from the exponent, and this integral reduces to the original one. So the simpler picture involves large n, but in general, I'm burning here an important detail, but in general, basically, there's a parameter n, and the naive model we started with corresponding to setting n equals 1. That's like a strongly coupled quantum version of a model that has a more transparent interpretation when n is large. For large n, we get something like string theory, where two-dimensional surfaces of all topology are possible, but the ones of simple topology are favored. I express that the geometry has some singularities, but in limit that it becomes a dense random graph, on the average, on a large scale, those singularities aren't very important. We build up more reasonable two-dimensional geometries on a large scale, which I'm just drawing here without showing their granular structure that comes from the graphs. And what I'm emphasizing, though, is that the ones with simple topology are favored. Just as in string theory, if you're familiar with string theory. But if you're not familiar with string theory, you might want to imagine that a quantum gravity theory can get some insight about it. In quantum physics, in general, all things can happen. But when there's a semi-classical picture, it's because some things are likelier than others. So in quantum gravity, all space-time geometries and topologies are possible. But something you'd be able to understand intuitively would be something where simple ones are in some way favored over others. And what that means here is that the sphere is favored over the torus, which is favored over a Riemann surface of genus 2, and so on. So I've sketched, and I've taken longer in sketching it than I intended, so I'm afraid this lecture is going to take a little longer than intended, plus we started then. But anyway, what I sketched is what was done in the late 80s, and this program was very successful at giving models of two-dimensional quantum gravity that, first of all, were exactly soluble from the matrix integral. So that involves things I won't explain. I wrote down the matrix integral, which I didn't even completely explain why it was correct. But then there are techniques we need to calculate the integral. And secondly, they could be given a semi-classical interpretation of string theories. It's an important fact, but again, I won't explain it today. What we've arrived at, we could call a model of emergent gravity. Because superconductivity emerges from electrons in the nuclei. If you look closely at a few electrons in the nuclei, there's no superconductivity. If you put together 10 to the 20 of them, then you can describe, lo and behold, it's superconductivity emerges as a useful concept. What I've told you here, a simple random graph isn't going to give you any kind of two-dimensional geometry. Well, will not give you what you want to call a quantum gravity theory. Write down the integral and adjust the parameters so that the tip of all gravity becomes dense. And then just as superconductivity emerges from 10 to the 20 electrons and nuclei, so here, a model of two-dimensional gravity appears out of thin air. Microscopically, there's only a matrix, but macroscopically, there is a two-dimensional. In this light, there's an important point. So we got gravity out of nothing, meaning only a matrix. But it's very important that we got gravity together with the space-time in which the gravity happens. So what emerged was not just gravity, but the space-time in which the gravity happened. What did not happen was to start with a space-time without gravity, and then to somehow generate gravity in that space-time. Instead, in the microscopic formulation, there wasn't any space-time. And what was generated was the space-time together with its geometry. And the geometry was a fluctuating geometry. So we generated spontaneously a space-time with its quantum fluctuating geometry. There's actually a general lesson here, which is common to all models of emergent gravity. If you start in a d-dimensional spacetime with an ordinary theory without gravity, and here it doesn't matter if your ordinary theory is a continuum theory or some kind of cutoff theory, perhaps on a lattice, then you have some sort of gauge-invariant local field, it's phi x. Here x is a point in spacetime made on a lattice. But a theory with gravity doesn't have gauge-invariant local fields that depend on the choice of a space-time point. Because in general relativity, x is a gauge-invariant, so phi of x can't be the space-time in which the gravity emerges. I consider this an important lesson of all models of emergent gravity. I have to tell you, my view isn't universally shared, in the sense that in the literature you can find many papers with attempts to generate emergent gravity in the pre-existing spacetime. I claim to have told you why that won't work. That's what this page is about. I claim to have told you in these three or four sentences why, if you want to generate gravity as an emergent phenomenon, you have to generate space-time along with it. And later on, I'll tell you about another type of concrete model in which this happens. For now, though, let's go back to our one-dimensional graph. So remember, I said that we were going to do quantum gravity in one dimension, but we stuck it to two dimensions. But we at least started trying to talk about one dimension. And I said that one-dimensional geometry was going to be, at most, that we had a length parameter for each edge of the graph. But we then proceeded to construct a model without those length parameters. But I hope that you had so much fun that you're anxious to know what would have happened if we had included the length parameters. So we include the length parameters by placing a Riemannian metric on the graph. Now, in quantum theory, we're supposed to integrate over all the variables, which in quantum gravity means integrating over metrics from Lagrangian morphisms. But here, metrics from Lagrangian morphisms are just the keys. But we have to elaborate on the model in some way, or it won't be known. See, suppose that with no interaction between the different t's, we just integrate over the t's. Well, the t's are positive real numbers, so we need a measure of the positive real lines to enable us to do the integral. If we pick a measure which is integrable, then after doing the integral, we'll just have got rid of the t's and we'll be back to the model that didn't have t's. So although we could do that, it's not the interesting thing to do. Interesting meaning different from what I already described. What's more interesting, the measure we'll use will actually be the ordinary real measure on the half line. It's non-integrable. The real line, the positive half line has an infinite length. So what will enable us to the integral, but also what will make the model new, is that we'll elaborate upon the model by the fact that the integrand will have some function that depends on the different t's, not just one t at a time, but some couplings, as to use physics jargon, between the different t's. But we want to maintain the concept that one-dimensional physics is local. You see, t is the integrated length of this segment. But it is the integrated length. It's the integral of the Riemannian length element. Being the integrated length, it's the integral of a local function. Now, a function like that depends on two t's that you define in a naive way will violate the locality of physics. For instance, a perfectly good function that involves t1 and t2 is the product t1 times t2. But it's not allowed because it's not a local integral. So we want to integrate over the t-graph. We want to live in a world where what we are integrating is locally defined on the graph. So there's a physically natural way to do this. I'm not going to claim, I don't know what the mathematician would say about this question. I will only tell you what physicists consider natural to do. A physically natural way to proceed is to consider one-dimensional general relativity not by itself, but with some additional fields. After all, that would be more like the real world. In the real world, there's gravity, but there's also electromagnetism, and there are electrons, muons, and neutrinos. So instead of just doing general relativity in one dimension, let's do general relativity with some additional fields, which for simplicity I will take to be these scalar fields, x1 onto x2. So you could think of the scalar fields as a map from the graph to RD. RD is d-dimensional Euclidean space. And the set of D, real value, a scalar field is just a real value function. So we introduce D, real value functions on the graph, that you can think of as defining a map from the graph to RD. So now I'm going to give an action on each edge of the graph. And as I told you, the action is required to be local, so I've written a local integral along the graph. Of what? Well, the action you want is a sum of the contributions, one for each edge. Well, I'll write a formula for the action for a particular edge. Well, the edge is a Riemannian manifold with a length element ds. So we integrate ds. Well, ds times gss is the Riemannian metric of the edge. This is the Riemannian length element. And I just take a constant. That's, if we just integrate a constant, we get the length of the edge times m squared. But to that, I want to add the gradient squared of the amount of x from the edge to Rd. So in physical language, I've written down the action for d scalar fields in one dimension. The most elementary combination, but this is the first Lagrangian physics student going into, maybe without the constants, where s is interpreted as time, gss is 1, x is the position of the particle. There's usually a 1/2 in front that I've left out, or actually 1/2 m, and this term is the kinetic energy of the one particle. So that's the rough idea, but we're doing it coupled to one-dimensional quantum gravity. So now we do a path integral over all pairs, g and x, where g is a metric on the graph, and x is a map from the graph to a d-dimensional space function, which we'll take to be just a flat manifold Rd. We could generalize it, but we won't for this estimation. The action on each edge is what I wrote. We also include the same factors as before at vertices. But as I told you way back, we're not going to get something interesting unless the different edges are coupled. And in the model I described, there's one and only one way to couple. I had an action that involved a map of this edge to Rd, and there also was a map that involved an action involved this map of this edge to Rd. But we require that the pieces fit together to a continuous map from the graph to Rd. In other words, at vertices, the x's of different edges are supposed to agree. That will be the only coupling between the different edges. You see, what we've accomplished that is more interesting than just taking t1 times t2 is that we've coupled the different edges, but we've done it in a completely local fashion. There is a locally defined map from this edge to Rd with a local action, same on this edge. And the condition that the two maps agree at the vertex is a perfectly local condition. So, this is what we want to do. We want to integrate over pairs consisting of Riemannian metrics on the graph and maps of the graph to Rd. This is actually not a hard problem to understand. The only thing is that it's hard to explain it in 5 minutes. When it's part of a longer lecture, and you've already started to wonder about it. Suppose we only had one edge, and let the boundary values of the two edges be x and x prime. The reason I'm going to keep fixed the boundary values is that those are the only things we need to know when we glue different edges together to make a graph. So, if we could do the prime integral on a single edge with fixed boundary values, then by gluing the edges together and integrating over the boundary values, we'll get the complete answer. So let t be the length of this edge. So we describe the edge by a Riemannian metric with parameter s that runs from 0 to 2, with gss being 1. And then the action of the edge looks like this. And as I said before, this is essentially the first action we run into when we study Lagrangian mechanics. So it's the action for a free particle, the Hamiltonian, p squared plus m squared. And according to Feynman, well, Feynman taught us how to do the path integral. The path integral describes the propagation of a free particle with that Hamiltonian through imaginary time t. And then, if you take it to Fourier transform, you get the path integral with fixed boundary values, x and x prime. So, Some of you will understand the explanation I've just given, but if you haven't heard it before, it definitely needs a longer explanation. What I've explained here is one of Feynman's basic formulas. To say I explained it is misleading. What I've stated here is one of Feynman's basic formulas. But unfortunately, in today's brief excursion through quantum gravity, there are a few of Feynman's basic formulas that we don't really have time to properly explain, and this is one of them. So I think that if you aren't familiar with the formula, just accept the idea that it is a basic formula of Feynman's that you'll learn if you go far enough with quantum mechanics, that tells you how to do the path integral on a single edge with x and x prime fixed. And we get this thing. But we're supposed to integrate over t, because t is the Riemannian length of that edge, and we're supposed to integrate over all Riemannian elements. And because of this nice interval, that the integral from 0 to infinity dt of e to the minus at is 1 over a, well, see, the t dependence of this thing is e to the minus ta, where this is a. So if we integrate over t, we get a function that those of you who have studied a little bit of quantum field theory will recognize as the Feynman propagator for a scalar field in a d-dimensional spacetime. This is, according to Feynman, the propagator from x to x prime of a scalar field of mass in d dimensions. Now, when we do the path integral for a graph, here I've drawn a different graph from the one we had before. This happens to be a graph with 6 vertices, which I've numbered, and a certain number of edges that I didn't number. It looks like there are 9 of them. So what we're supposed to do is to keep fixed each of the x's of the vertices. And then we do the Feynman integral on the edge using Feynman's formula. This is basically Feynman's formula for the path integral on the edge. And then we multiply together 9 copies of this formula, one for each edge, and then iterate over the x's. Well, if you've studied your Feynman diagrams and you think about it a little bit, you'll see that what I've just described is part of a textbook derivation of Feynman diagrams in quantum field theory. The integral over the x's, we wrote the Feynman propagators in momentum space, and there's a different p for each edge. But the integrals over the x's can be done quite easily because of the exponential dependence, and imposes momentum conservation of the vertex. And after also including the factors of the vertices, you get something which is familiar if you've studied quantum field theory a little bit. What we've arrived at is the Feynman diagram extension of a scalar field theory in d dimensions. So I did this, and we got scalar field theory here. Remember, we were trying to do one-dimensional quantum gravity, but to make it interesting, we needed to add matter, and we added scalar matter. That's why we got a scalar field. But a variant of this would have given us other kinds of matter. So what we learned here is more or less that any standard quantum theory in d dimensions for anything can be associated to quantum gravity in one dimension. So in the interpretation of what one-dimensional quantum gravity meant, where we were supposed to integrate over the lengths of the edges, the answer in what is one-dimensional quantum gravity is that it encompasses all of conventional quantum physics without gravity. And in a sense, that means that it encompasses very, very large parts of classical geometry. I just say that if you happen to be a mathematician more familiar with quantum geometry than with quantum field theory, with classical geometry than with quantum field theory, you can. The same story with no loops in your graphs would be the classical loop. And if you like, you can think of classical geometry as coming from one-dimensional quantum gravity. So I hope you've enjoyed this as much as I have. But you may ask if it's useful. We can hang up on the wall a statement that all the standard physics that we usually do can be understood as one-dimensional quantum gravity. But if in the end we just do the usual stuff, what have we gained by learning that? Well, one reason it's useful is that it leads to a generalization of quantum field theory. And to my thinking, the generalization of quantum field theory that leads to is the only real generalization of quantum field theory that anyone's ever discovered. It's not just a generalization of quantum field theory, but as far as we know, it's the generalization of quantum field theory. So what we did was we started with quantum gravity in one dimension, including an integration over lengths to make it more realistic. And the procedure that I described led to ordinary quantum field theory in space. What would happen if you start with quantum gravity above one dimension? Let's try two dimensions. Well, in the starting point, we're supposed to replace graphs by two-dimensional manifolds, or in other words, Riemann surfaces. So here's a Riemann surface. One thing we notice immediately is that we can assume our Riemann surfaces are smooth. We don't have to, but we can. And unlike the graphs, where we had to introduce singularities to get anything, in two dimensions, we can deal with smooth geometries. So there are no need to introduce cubic, quartic, and so on vertices, and therefore, there aren't adjustable coupling constants, lambda 3 and lambda 4. So the theory, if it works, is going to be less arbitrary than was the route that led from one-dimensional quantum gravity to ordinary quantum physics. However, to get an interesting analog of what we did in the one-dimensional case requires one more key idea. Unlike one manifold, a two-manifold can be curved, and the space of metrics modulated by coordinate transformations is infinite-dimensional. You see, a two-by-two metric tensor is a symmetric two-by-two matrix with three independent components. But a diffeomorphism generator only depends on two functions, not enough to gauge fix the three components of G, even locally. So the geometry of a graph only involved finitely many parameters, and that was crucial. But the geometry of a two-manifold involved infinitely many parameters. So one way to proceed is to accept the fact that we have to do a bounding interval over the third component of G and try to make sense of it. So it's a fascinating story. It's actually a hard way to make a living. But one version of this actually leads back to the matrix model of two-dimensional quantum gravity that we discussed before, the model with the n-by-n matrix. So there's a fascinating story when you do proceed exactly as is suggested here, integrating over the third component of G. But that's, to my thinking, that's not the most illuminating way to proceed. There's another option. We get something nice if we impose an extra symmetry that eliminates one component of G. And there's a beautiful symmetry, which is to require conformal invariance or Weyl invariance, where we take any real-value function sigma, and we consider two metrics equivalent if they differ by multiplication by a positive function. If we do that, then you see, this, together with diffeomorphisms, enables us locally to modulate this operation of diffeomorphisms, any two metrics are equivalent locally. So we're back in a similar situation to that for the graph, where any small piece was just a line with no invariant information except its length. A 19th century result says that up to diffeomorphisms and conformal or Weyl transformations, a two-manifold sigma depends on only finitely many parameters. So I've drawn an example, but I've drawn a comparison between graphs and two-manifolds because it's important in our intuition. So here's a graph. This particular graph has three real parameters because there are three edges. This is a graph with three edges and two vertices. Now I've drawn a two-manifold that looks a lot like this if you look at it from the distance. But if you're up close and you see, if this circumference is small enough and this distance is long enough, this tube might just look like that one. So you can approximate this two-manifold by that graph. But of course the graph has singularities if the two-manifold is completely smooth. The 19th century result says that this two-manifold, its geometry up to Weyl transformations, only depends on three parameters, tau 1, tau 2, and tau 3, which in some ways are quite analogous to T1, T2, and T3. Well, with some crucial differences, one of which is that the taus are complex parameters while the t's are real. Concretely, we could write tau as a real number plus I times another real number, where the t's, the imaginary parts of the taus, are like the t's that you see here, and the s's are twist apples. You could cut one of these tubes along the circle, twist one side loops back together and glue it back together, and that would introduce this parameter s. For today's lecture, all we need to know about the s's is that they're endless. So they run over a compact space from 0 to 2 pi. So we could now try to integrate over this finite set of parameters, the taus, analogous to the integral over the t's. But the integral over the t's was more interesting if we added matter fields. And the same proves to be true for the integral over the taus. So, just as in one dimension, we're going to add matter to our two-dimensional gravity theory. However, since we're using conformal invariants to improve the analogy between two dimensions and one dimension, conformal invariants is supposed to eliminate the integral over two metrics in favor of an integral over finitely many parameters tau, the matter part of the action will have to be conformally invariant. So it's also, of course, supposed to be a local integral. So whatever the action is, it's supposed to be a local integral over our two manifold, but rho should be conformally invariant. I've written an example. The axis describe a map from our two manifold signal to a space-time M. I've taken M type D dimensions, and I have endowed it with a metric tensor, which I've called GIJ of X. And then I've written the action function for a map from signal to the space-time X. Now, to develop the theory, we're going to do the analog of what we did for the graph. For a fixed sigma, that means for fixed parameters, tau, we'll describe sigma, we'll do a finite integral over the fields x, and then we'll integrate over the moduli, and finally, we'll sum over all topological choices for sigma, just as in the case of the graph, we summed over all possible graphs. When we did this in one dimension, we got ordinary quantum field theory in M. What happens in the two-dimensional case? The miracle is that we get a generalization of ordinary quantum field theory that has an interpretation in terms of quantum gravity plus other fields in M. Remember, what quantum gravity means, as we said at the beginning, is a quantum theory that can be approximated as general relativity at long distances will be test general. So in that sense, we get a generalization of ordinary quantum field theory that incorporates gravity. There are a couple of steps involved in explaining this. So you'll have to forgive me for cutting a few corners in this explanation, since as much as I like to know, I don't really want to keep here all day. I want to explain that the theory we're going to get has an interpretation in M. So I want to tell you something about its interpretation. So M is called the target space, just for jargon. So, you see, just as for the graphs, we constructed a theory that had an interpretation as a standard theory in M. Now we're going to get a theory that has an interpretation as an unusual theory in M. But I want to tell you at least a little bit about what kind of interpretation it has. In the usual case on M, the fields in quantum theory correspond to the external lines in a finite diagram. Unfortunately, I didn't properly explain this before, but when Feynman drew finite diagrams, he was computing scattering amplitudes between initial and final particles, and the particles corresponded to external lines that go off to infinity, coming off of the graph. So Feynman was not mainly interested in a closed graph, but a graph that had some external lines corresponding to observable particles. The analog of an external line is now an external tube that goes off to infinity. So the fields in the target space for Feynman are the initial conditions that we can place at the line infinity. So here, the field will be the initial conditions we can place at the end of the long tube. But you see, in one case, what does the initial condition do? Well, it sets up the mode of vibration of the tube. Of the tube just describes a string propagating in time. So one answer is that the fields are the vibrational modes of a string. Well, I do want to tell you another answer. I'm not going to explain this other answer in detail. I'll just explain it enough to explain why there's an interpretation in terms of quantum gravity. Suppose we change the metric of m a little bit, by g going to g plus delta g. The action will change a little bit. And when we do the Feynman interval, we'll have the exponential of minus the action, but now we've added a little bit to the action. And if we work to first order in delta g, the correction to the action, well, it gets integrated over the surface. When we calculate, we've got an operator here, but it's integrated over the surface, and we'll have to do an operator insertion on the surface somewhere. So I picked a point, this red dot, on our two manifold, where this operator might be inserted. So a deformation of our theory is associated with an insertion at a point on our surface, whereas one of the observable fields in spacetime is associated with the two. But there's a miracle that only happens in two dimensions and requires conformal invariance. Those two are equivalent. By the magic of conformal invariance, the point where we inserted the operator, this point, can be projected to infinity and can be regarded as lying at the end of an infinite tube. And the end of the infinite tube is where, according to Feynman, we impose the boundary conditions corresponding to an observable particle or field in spacetime. So we've learned that that one of the external fields amounts to shifting the metric in spacetime. So in other words, we've learned that the theory is going to describe the dynamics of quantum gravity. What I've explained, and I've probably gone through it way too quickly, just like I've probably explained almost everything way too quickly today. But what I've explained is that the dynamics of gravity in spacetime is part of what string theory describes. A shift in the metric of spacetime is a shift in the expectation value of one of the string fields, or differently put, one of the string fields is the spacetime metric. This can be further elaborated in a systematic way to calculate quantum processes involving graviton, free of the ultraviolet divergences that one would get if one tries to quantize Einstein's theory directly. The theory is not equivalent to Einstein's theory. It's only equivalent to Einstein's theory at long distances where Einstein's theory is tested. And the ultraviolet is quite different, and in particular, is free of usual ultraviolet problems. The ultraviolet divergences are absent because it turns out that two-dimensional conformal invariance completely eliminates the ultraviolet region from the Feynman diagram. So, I apologize for stringing together a lot of things, none of which we've had time to fully explain. But what I could at least sketch is that string theory, which is the theory I've described, though it seems to start out as a theory of quantum gravity in two dimensions, earns another interpretation as a theory of quantum gravity in d dimensions. That's why it may be possible to use string theory to describe quantum gravity in the real world. But there's something else that emerges from the same kind of reasoning. I started with an example of a conformally invariant two-dimensional action. But then we considered changing the action a little bit by changing the metric. And that made equal sense in string theory. And by extending the reasoning I just explained, we end up finding out that any conformally invariant two-dimensional action to a more abstract notion that does not involve talking about spacetime. The more abstract notion is any conformally invariant two-dimensional theory with the correct central charge. So in this more general theory, which eliminates the infinities from quantum gravity, gravity in space-time is only one of the things that can happen. It can also describe more abstract situations that are farther from ordinary things, which may be more important near the Big Bang, or perhaps near the singularity of a black hole. So this is the paradigm that string theorists had 20 years ago. Quantum gravity in space-time is described by the most general two-dimensional conformally invariant theory. Okay, I'm really only beginning to go over now. We started late, which I accept no responsibility. So I've now spoken for the correct length of time, and it's only now that I'm starting to go over. So this paradigm that I described is powerful enough to describe phenomena that we can think about, but unfortunately we can't really measure, where general relativity breaks down because of strong curvature. And instead of constructing our two-dimensional field theory using map fields X to describe mapping to space-time, we construct it using more general quantum fields. So this is a powerful approach that led to many interesting phenomena and surprises. And for a while, it looked like string theorists were becoming specialists of two-dimensional quantum field theory. That was because, although we were doing two-dimensional gravity, the variable part of the theory was a two-dimensional field theory that was conformally invariant. So a lot of the fun had to do with the intricacies of two-dimensional field theory. So roughly speaking, that was the dominant paradigm of string theory until some point in the 1990s. But this picture emphasizing two-dimensional quantum field theory turned out to be incomplete. Most glaringly, it's incomplete because it was found in the 90s that string theory has non-perturbative expressions known as brains. A brain is an extended object, like a string, but possibly a finite dimension. What I've drawn here, very schematically, because I'm not much of an artist, I've drawn brains that each have two space dimensions. I haven't drawn time. And these, I've drawn pieces of these brains, which I've cut so that you can see that there are several parallel brains. These are meant to be three approximately parallel brains, which each have two space dimensions. Since they have two space dimensions, you can call them membranes. The English language has a convenient word membrane for two-dimensional objects, but it's got no convenient word for the d-dimensional generalization. So people just started calling these things brains. It turns out that roughly, to study the motion of a string, you use 1+1 or two-dimensional quantum field theory, but it turns out that to describe the motion of a brain with two space dimensions uses three-dimensional quantum field theory. And more generally, to describe a brain whose world volume has d dimensions, meaning d minus one space and one time dimension, we need to use d-dimensional quantum field theory. So all values of d occur, so in the 90s it turned out that in a sense, all possible quantum field theory in all dimensions is part of the string theory story. As they say, string theory is the theory of everything. I could say that this was more to my liking. I had spent the early part of my career studying quantum field theory, mostly in four dimensions, with other dimensions as practice cases. And there was a lot of nice stuff in higher dimensions. So during the period that we were focusing on the two-dimensional case, it seemed that a lot of wisdom about quantum field theory was being wasted. So the new paradigm means that nothing is wasted. Because in a sense, all insights about quantum field theory in all dimensions are meaningful as part of the string theory story. It's all a question of what question to ask. Now, we could go in all kinds of directions here, but as I say, I don't want to keep you here all day. So we're just going to focus on one side of this. So brains are described by quantum field theory, but they're also objects that can exist in string theory. And string theory, among other things, is a theory of quantum gravity. So any object has a gravitational field and a particular set is the brain. So the brain is the source of a gravitational field. For example, just like we can make a black hole out of tables and chairs, we can make a black hole out of brains, or at least one can imagine that happening in the context of string theory. We can either study the quantum field theory along the brain or the spacetime that the brain produces. The great discovery that was made in 1997 by Paul Singer, following some clues from work by other people, of gauge gravity duality, says that these two are equivalent. You can either study the quantum field theory along the brain or the spacetime that the brain produces. These are equivalent even though there are completely different types of theories and spacetimes are different dimensions. So the theory of the brain is an ordinary quantum field theory, a gauge theory without gravity on the boundary of the point plane. So from the explanation I'm giving, it's not completely clear in what sense the brain is on the boundary. There are a few tricks involved. In this correspondence, you're studying from near the geometry near the brain. And then in that so-called near horizon geometry, the brain lives on the boundary. So there's a useful picture where the brain is projected to infinity. And this is a very schematic diagram. I've just drawn a circle that represents infinity. And a disk represents a manifold of higher dimensions, boundaries of infinity. There are two equivalent descriptions. One is by an ordinary theory of the boundary, and the other is by gravity in the bulk. So what was discovered here is a very far-reaching situation in which an ordinary theory in one dimension is related to a gravity theory in a different dimension. It's shocking, but it might shock you less because I began the lecture with more elementary examples of that kind. For example, we have the matrix integral in zero dimensions that was related to quantum gravity in two dimensions. So, ordinary theory in one dimension, namely zero. Baby theory of quantum gravity in another dimension, namely two. What I'm telling you is that starting in 1997, string theorists, and starting by studying brains, string theorists discover a fantastic analog in higher dimensions, where the gauge theory, for example, could be in four dimensions, and could be very similar to the standard model of particle physics. In that case, the quantum gravity theory would be in five dimensions. Alternatively, the quantum gravity theory could be in four dimensions, the theory of the real world, and then the gauge theory will be a two-space, one-dimensional theory, somewhat qualitatively like the systems that condensed matter physicists use when they study something like the quantum Hall effect or high temperature superconductivity, which are essentially two plus one dimensional phenomena. So this duality between the brains and quantum gravity is a sort of giant version of the simple examples we discussed at the beginning, in which an ordinary theory without gravity, in that case, a simple matrix integral that we might want to call a Newton-Leibniz integral rather than a Feynman integral, generated an emergent two-dimensional gravity theory. As in that case, the emergent theory with gravity does not live in the same spacetime in which the ordinary theory was defined. Here, the ordinary theory lives on the boundary, and gravity lives in a bulk theory of the world, whose boundary is where the ordinary theory is. All this reflects something we discussed. If you wish to generate emergent gravity, you have to generate space-time. If you're trying to generate superconductivity, you can start with electrons and nuclei in space-time. You don't have to generate space-time because gravity isn't what you're trying to generate, just superconductivity. But if you're trying to generate gravity, you have to generate space-time more. This gauge gravity duality, though harder to explain than the elementary example we started with, really has a lot of applications. I'm not going to describe them today because I do want you all to get on with your day, but I'll just briefly summarize that the applications are of two types. By mapping gauge theory to gravity, you get insights about the difficult problems of gauge theory, with new insights about phenomena ranging from quark confinement to heavy ion collisions and quantum critical points. Conversely, by mapping gravity to gauge theory, you can understand some of the fundamentals of black holes and maybe others if you're clever. And as well, the duality certainly gives the best we have by way of a non-perturbative explanation of what quantum gravity means in spacetimes that are more realistic. Spacetimes of four dimensions, something that's a little bit more like the real world. Quantum gravity is just equivalent to a theory of the standard type living on the boundary. Now, for those who have to ask, how general is this correspondence? And Okay, the answer was I don't completely know, but I'll tell you what I think the answer most likely is. When we discussed strings, we started with a special case, a special conformally invariant action. Well, we ended up deciding that any other conformally invariant action was part of the same story. Some examples are just easier to understand and interpret than others. It seems that the answer is similar for gauge gravity dualities. All ordinary theories participate in this duality, but the gravitational pull of a given ordinary theory is easier to understand in some cases than in others. The reason for this belief is that starting with one example, you can generate many more by normalization of flow. You can do it in many different ways, and you build up an incredible web of examples that do have gravitational pulls. And it seems that there's no reasonable place to stop, except by saying that they all have gravitational pulls, whether you can understand them or not. So, there seems to be no reasonable stopping point short of this universal statement. So, you know, I've had some fun today telling you about some of my favorite things from the last 25 years or so. But we might want to ask if we can say anything about the big question of what quantum gravity really means. I'd say that not much in sight. Even though we have a framework to systematically compute quantum gravity amplitudes, and also a framework that gives a non-perturbative definition in certain space-times of quantum gravity as an emergent phenomenon, we seem to have little real understanding of what it all means. Somehow, there should be a clue in the fact that we always end up talking about all possible examples of this or that. These are not very natural notions in the rest of physics, where normally, to discuss a family of quantum field theories, we start from an ultraviolet fixed point and consider marginal or relevant deformations from there. We don't have a good, in any other branch of physics, a good way of thinking about all possible this or that. There isn't an ultraviolet fixed point that we know about all possible theories, so we don't have a sensible framework to talk about all possible this or that. So we're missing some better way to think about things, or at least I hope so. Personally, I suspect that one cause of the difficulty is that the answer we want is more abstract than we are accustomed to. But on the bright side, since we don't have much insight about what it all means, it was much more fun to learn. Thank
you. Thank you for your interesting lecture. I have a question. What are your thoughts regarding the ideas of people like Diossi and Penrose regarding or concerning the notion that we might need to change also quantum theory when we mix quantum theory and gravitation? In some sense, these ideas lead us to the problem of the measuring problem in quantum mechanics. What are your thoughts regarding the possible connection between the measurement problem in quantum mechanics and the interface between quantum theory and gravitation?
So personally, I've got no objection in principle to modify quantum mechanics if one can do it in a way that makes sense. I haven't heard any interesting ideas, whereas I have heard interesting ideas along lines of modifying gravity, as I described. If you ask where it might happen, I think the most interesting challenge to the meaning of quantum mechanics involves cosmology. So I think that the most interesting frontier involving thinking about what quantum mechanics means is in the context of the inflationary universe. So I think that the developments there are very interesting, and it's imaginable that they would shed new light on what quantum mechanics means, although it hasn't happened yet.
Any other questions?
There was a question about that, or at least somebody was asking it.
think this one is not working. Yeah.
Just ask the question.
Has the advances in the late 90s about the graphs, Parabasi and that kind of guys, dense graphs, has anything to do with one dimensional quantum theory?
I'm not sure. The question is about advances involving dense graphs. Yes. But it's not clear to me if you're talking about it. So I talked about it with some other advances with dense graphs. Because graphs may have been studied from many different points of view. There probably are a lot of interesting things about graphs that haven't yet been considered in this language. But I'm not sure what you're asking about.
Has that advances for any like this kind of problem?
I don't know exactly which advances you're asking about, so the answer may well be right now. But what has been most applied to this kind of problems are questions about graphs that can be conveniently answered by expressing the counting in terms of an interval. So that's a quick summary of that's the main method that physicists in this field use. So that's one. Those are the aspects of graphs that have been most related to quantum gravity. But maybe there's some other methods.
Is it?
Some days ago, I see a TV program that somebody is working with a model with E-groups, E-groups, and these are the same, well, are related models, or it's all
there are E-groups everywhere in standard form. My discussion of standard quantum theory today was so schematic that I didn't emphasize the Lie groups. But there are Lie groups everywhere. There's gauge theory, there's SU3 times SU3 number. So the answer to your question is not only yes, but yes, we might be able to answer it.
Yes, I got lost when you were explaining that the generalization of quantum theory that you were describing was the unique generalization. Will you please clarify us?
When I said that this generalization was unique, what I meant was that on planet Earth, and this is to my thinking, is the only generalization of quantum theory that is truly interesting that humans have discovered.
Yeah,
it wasn't meant as a cosmic statement of uniqueness.
Okay.
And I don't know what's been discovered elsewhere in the galaxy.
But that's the point I don't understand. What is unique about that it's only with this generalization we can still describe physics in four-dimensional theory?
It's the only generalization of quantum field theory that's known that preserves the successes of quantum field theory while modifying quantum field theory in an interesting way. I'm telling you my view. One of the phrases in the sentences was the only generalization that's known. There's no theorem here saying that it's the only imaginable generalization or the only one that we've discovered.
Okay.
I'm only saying that, and I'm only telling you as far as my work. Personally, I work in this direction because it's the only known framework that to me seems like an interesting known way to go beyond quantum field theory in an interesting fashion while preserving the successes.
Okay, so now just to understand a little bit more about the interests you have on this, it's just the discussion that string theory can emerge from that. Is that one?
I couldn't quite hear that one, sorry.
Yes, I mean, what is so interesting for you?
I think the question was what is so interesting? Yeah. But it's, what is so interesting? Quantum field theory is a very successful theory, but in its standard form, it has two problems. It's almost impossible to modify it without making any sense. That last sentence is one of the main reasons physics made so much progress in the 20th century. If there were many possible imaginable variants of the theory, the standard model of particle physics wouldn't have been discovered. What physicists discovered was an incredibly rigid framework, so rigid that it's virtually impossible to modify it, make any sense, and sufficiently rigid that with limited clues it was possible to discover the standard model. However, this framework doesn't allow gravity. Both out of curiosity about how the framework of physics can be changed, and curiosity about quantum gravity, one wonders if there is any way to modify quantum gravity while preserving its successes. I'm making the assertion, take it or leave it. I'm not saying it here, I'm not telling you my opinion. I'll tell you, string theory is the only interesting modification of standard quantum field theory that preserves its successes.
Okay, thank you.
Regarding this gauge gravity duality, which aspect do you think would be the most challenging?
It's challenging in all directions. So, if you're interested, I say that in fact there's more applications of quantum by using gravity to describe ordinary fields. So, for example, heavy ion physics, quantum critical points, and quark confinement are three problems involving ordinary physics. They all involve some explanation of the worthy duality that's been used. But the most striking success of using the duality to shed light on gravity has to do with fundamental questions of black holes. So most applications, if you just count the numbers of applications, most applications have gone from gravity to ordinary theory. But if instead of just counting, you feel you should weight them properly, then we have to decide how to weight them, and I don't know what the important measure is. So I think it's best to say that there are a lot of applications in both directions and they're all interesting. There's an incredible web of different things.
You mentioned that the beam modes are, could be a smoking gun or an effect of quantum gravity.
Yes.
Another is the non-dose entities produce, non-dose entities produce spin inflation.
Yes. So the point was, I had said at the beginning that quantum gravity effects might be observed in the polarization of the cosmic microwave radiation. And the point is correctly made that it's imaginable that such effects would show up in non-Gaussian entities. The reason I didn't mention it is that I thought that the beam mode is the best chance of positive observation. And since I was trying to be brief, I just mentioned the one which was possibly most likely. But the search for non-Gaussian entity is also exciting.
Thank you.
We have two more questions and then we'll
Hello. I'm going to make a politically incorrect question. You told us about the problems one faces when trying to quantize theory at the perturbative, quantize gravity to the perturbative approach.
Yes.
And I wonder what's your view of the non-perturbative approach that is considered by loop quantum gravity.
Well, I'm the one who's going to say politically incorrect things. You didn't. What I'm going to tell you is that there hasn't been any interesting ideas. As I told you, the one who was going to say something politically incorrect was me. And my politically incorrect statement is that although I have no general objection, there haven't been any interesting ideas yet. I will say one more thing, though. Once upon a time, there was the Fermi theory of weak interactions, and it was perturbable and unnormalizable. And if you look it up, you will discover that in 1967 and 8, Abdus Salam wrote two papers. One with gravity, he tried to quantize the Fermi theory non-perturbatively. The other was his contribution to the beginning of the standard model of particle physics by modifying the weak interaction theory so it could be quantized. One of those two stood the test of time. Now, what happened for weak interactions doesn't say what will happen for gravity. But my attitude is pragmatic. As I said at the beginning, I only work on quantum gravity because it has turned out that it's possible to do interesting things. And I work in the direction of where I think it has proved possible to do interesting things, which is my answer to your question. If it hadn't proved possible to do interesting things, then I would have taken the advice of those people who think that the energy scale is so high and there are so few experimental clues that quantum gravity is too far away. So the type of thing you've asked about is an example of what I would not have chosen to spend my career on. So, I have been politically incorrect.
I appreciate it.
Is some religion...
I thought it was my duty, so it made this easy. Yeah.
Is there some relation with the last talk of Kolanov, homology with quantum gravity?
Well, there's not a... There's something which I may have given a small taste of, which is that string theory is part of a vast interconnected web of all kinds of things. Only a tiny amount of the total picture is known, but even so, there is an incredible number of things known and an incredible number of connections between them. Now, it has the property that even if you look at a small piece of it under a magnifying glass, it's kind of scaling right now. The small piece itself have many different facets connected by an incredible web. If you blow up a small, small part of this picture with your magnifying glass, and then you increase the magnification and get it again and again, then you get a tiny, tiny piece of this picture that I spent 2 years working on for my description of Kovan ophthalmology. But to tell you how Kovan ophthalmology fit into a tiny, tiny picture of today's lecture would really be an honest story. I was urged to have one of the lectures be about physics. You see, lecturing about how Kovan ophthalmology fits into this picture would have been fun to some, but it wouldn't have been.
Y bueno, muchísimas gracias por su asistencia. Agradecemos al profesor Wittgenstein. The Lancet Lectures ya terminaron, pero continúa el Congreso de dos charlas más. Sin embargo, la foto del Congreso va a ser en la piramidita esta de... ¿No la va a tomar Toño? Y va a ser en la piramidita ahí frente al Departamento de Matemáticas, las escaleritas, ¿no? So the conference picture is at the stairs next to the coffee shop where we've been hanging around. So it's now, so let's move to the middle staircase for the conference picture.